This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
I always like to start the speaker series each quarter with a bang, and we absolutely are going to do that tonight with Kevin O'Connor. Kevin is an internet pioneer. Even though he is still a young man, he was literally one of the people that created what we know today as the internet. And I'm not exaggerating. If you read some of the press from back in the day, that's exactly how Kevin was designated. So you think about Jerry Yang, Jeff Bezos. Kevin O'Connor was there with DoubleClick, which was eventually sold to Google for $3.1 billion. So $1 billion company is fantastic, right? What if you've started two, like Kevin has? So Kevin also started a security company called ISS, which was later acquired by IBM for $1.3 billion. And I believe he is in the process of creating that third billion-dollar company with Find the Best, which is located right here in Santa Barbara. And Kevin will tell us a lot more about that. Let's welcome Kevin to our class.
I appreciate that. And thank you, John, for not introducing me as the inventor of the pop-up ad. I did not invent the pop-up ad. Technology was used to probably deliver a few billion of them, but we did not invent that. We love the TMP program. Probably half the company came out of the TMP program. And there's entrepreneurship programs all over the country. And a lot of them are, you know, I call this this is like the Navy SEAL program. You know, John doesn't pull any punches. We really talk about a lot of what I'm going to talk about today is, you know, being an entrepreneur is it's a pain in the ass. It is full of failure. You don't hear about those stories. You always hear about the, you know, the Zuckerbergs and the Snapchat guys, you know, on TechCrunch. It's a tough, full contact sport. But we love this program. A lot of the original people that came for Find the Best 4.5 years ago came out of here. They're willing to sleep in the yard. We paid them $23,000 a year. It was like nothing. They could barely survive, but they got lots of stock options. And now they're executives of the company, so it's pretty exciting. About 110 people right down in Summerlin QAD building. Probably half the company is UCSB. So we love you guys. Appreciate it. So I'm going to start off with kind of my early days. I grew up in a suburbia. All white, 100% white. Everything was like square miles. It was like picture perfect suburbia. And I went to high school in Detroit. Right? So I was freshman year, go to high school in Detroit, completely different experience. And I didn't drive. I was a freshman. So I had to catch a ride with some people. And I got a ride with these two hockey players, seniors. And I remember getting in their car, and they're like drinking beer after school. I'm like, yo, what's going on here? And we're driving through Detroit, and we come up to a stop sign, stoplight. And there was this old black man walking across the street, probably 75, 80 years old. The guy goes, hey, watch this. He calls the guy over. He goes, excuse me, sir. We're lost. Can you help us out? And the guy goes, yeah, sure. You look like nice young boys. Where are you boys trying to go? Guy grabs him by the collar, pulls him into the car, and punches him 3 times, unconscious, and throws him out of the car. And I'm sitting in the back saying, what the f*** is going on here? I've never seen anything like this. And I said nothing. I didn't tell anyone. I went home, didn't tell my parents. I was just shocked. And I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to tell my parents because I thought they'd tell the school, get these guys kicked out. And then I'd be a narc, and I'd get my ass beat. So I was scared. And I stewed on this for a year, and I decided in my life, it was a real pivotal moment, I said, I am never going to take this again. I'm never going to put myself in a position where I'll be bullied, that I'm going to be afraid to stand up for what's right. I'm always going to stand up for the weaker person, the person who's not advantaged. And you know, whether this is in business, whether it's in life, and you've all been in the situation, right? How many times have you not done anything? And it just eats at you. So I decided to do that, and I've tried to live my life that way. Now, it's got me in trouble. It's got my ass beat by cops. I've been thrown in jail for it. I got almost murdered for it, you know, so I've had guns pulled on me. So, but it's a great way of doing life. And what it does, what's really helped as an entrepreneur is that you just don't give up. You know, people are always telling you what's wrong. I've gone against the FTC, attorney generals, competitors. I mean, people are always coming after you, trying to do what's wrong. And you stand up, and what you do is you end up developing a respect. Your respect from your employees. I didn't do it for that, but you find out that people really respect people that stand up for what they believe in. And we recently went through this at Find the Best with patent trolls. 20 companies were sued, all unfairly. 19 of them settled. They knew they were innocent, but they settled because that was the expedient thing to do. I said, bullshit, we're going to go after this. You know, it's economically, it's the wrong thing to do, but we're going to go after these guys and we're going to win. And we did. We ended up crushing them. We're going to continue to crush them. So it's really, you know, an important lesson in life, especially in business, is you've got to stand up for principles. You've got to stand up for what you believe in, especially on being an entrepreneur, and I imagine most of you want to start your own company. Everyone's going to tell you that what you're doing is stupid, it's wrong, it's not right, and you can't listen to them. Sometimes you probably should listen to them, because sometimes we do things that is dumb, not right, especially in business. So one of the things that I was an inventor at a young age, like 14, my favorite night was garbage night. I'd go out and collect TVs and dismantle them. And my least favorite day was the morning after garbage night when I had to clean up all the trash that the raccoon scattered. So I came up with this invention that I discovered where I would electrocute the raccoon. And it solved my problem. And at a very young age, I finally learned like invention is about solving a problem. It's really that simple. If you solve somebody's problem, people buy your invention. So I had my road in life, the road of life all totally mapped out, like many of you, right? I was going to be an engineer. I was going to go get my PhD and go work at Bell Labs, pick up a couple of Nobel laureates, and you know, have a good life. Getting a PhD was really important to me. And the day that I got accepted to the PhD program in Michigan, something was going on around me. It was 1983, and there was all these people dropping out of college. It was guys named like Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and Larry Ellison. And the world was changing. The PC had just come into existence, and I decided that this is an incredible opportunity. And one of the things I learned about careers, and especially startups, I'm going to talk a little bit about this, is that when you put yourself in a position for opportunities, right? Arnold Palmer had a great line, the more he practices, the luckier he becomes. So when you put yourself in these positions for opportunities, and I haven't had the chance to program at IBM PC at a very one of the first ones that come out, you can seize these opportunities. And there's these huge things that come into your life. You don't plan for them, they just happen. And you gotta be able to seize upon them. Now, recognizing what's a good opportunity, that's the hard part. You know, is this a huge trend? Like PCs or the internet. You know, back in 1995, the internet was not a given, right, John? I mean, this was not. We struggled and fought. You know, a lot of people didn't believe in it. Or is it going to be something like clean tech, which is a fad, and people are going to lose a lot of money, have lost a lot of money on it? It's not a very popular position, I know. So the whole purpose of a business, you're going to go get your MBA, that's good, but it's real simple. The purpose of a business is to solve a problem. It's that easy. People think about, oh, the purpose of a business is to make profits. No, it's not. It's a derivative of solving a problem. And the challenge is to figure out what are those problems. Now, if you find our first company was ICC. It was to connect PCs into mainframes. We had 95% market share. It was really, really good. But the problem with it, it was a $30 million market. So it was a problem, but it wasn't a really big problem. We solved it better than anybody else. So If you want to build a big company, you got to solve a huge problem. If you want to build a company that's going to survive, you got to solve that problem better than anybody else. Right? So you got a lot of different competitors out there. They're all going to take different whacks at it. And whoever solves it the best and has the best marketing and sales and everything else is probably going to win. There was always this thing, I don't know if you probably heard, first mover advantage. Is it an advantage or is it a disadvantage? There's lots of first movers. I mean, Google was like 20th mover advantage. People think Facebook created the social networking. Wrong. They're probably number 30. There was plenty of other social networking companies. BlackBerry, inventor of the smartphone, you know, where are they? They're going to probably be sold off in pieces and end up as a company. So really, whoever comes with the best solution to the problem usually wins. The thing about finding problems is tough, though. So you hear about like market research. Go talk to customers. They're gonna tell you what they want. Well, they won't. Jobs had a great quote, which is someone asked Jobs about that. What do you think about market research? He goes, some people says give customers what they want, but that's not my approach. Our job is to figure out what they're gonna want before they do. I think Henry Ford once said, if I'd asked customers what they wanted, they would have told me a faster horse. People don't know what they want until you show it to them. That's why I never rely on market research. It's our task is to read things that are not yet on the page. And this is so true. When we first came up with the first company, tying pieces and PCs into mainframes, we were so excited. We wrote the code, we had developed some hardware, we had it. We took an ad out in the newspaper, the press that addressed Unisys Market, nobody called, zero. So we said, damn, okay, it's maybe a little more difficult than we thought. So we called people. We bought a list and we called them. First 100 companies, we talked to MIS managers. They told us PCs will never be allowed into our company, never. And it's gonna be over my dead body. And by the way, don't ever call me again. When we did DoubleClick on the internet, we asked people, but advertising on the internet, would you advertise on the internet? They said, why the hell would I advertise on the internet? There's a million people. I'll buy, television where there's, 500 million people. People don't know what they want. And so one of the mistakes, and people make this mistake all the time, and I made the mistake. One of the ideas that we had come up with at, before DoubleClick was basically job posting board, monster.com, right? You all use it. And I went, I talked to a bunch of VPs of human resources, and I said, how would you like a system where you could post your jobs on the internet? And they said, I wouldn't want that system at all. What's the internet? And B, who are you? We killed the idea. We said, none of these, we talked to 10 VP of HRs and they all said no. But we were asking the wrong question. The right question would have been, how would you like to reach the perfect audience instantly of qualified candidates? For 100th the price and accelerated the process of hiring. Would you like something like that? Yes, sir. Yes, that would be great. So trying to figure out, it's less important to try to figure out what people want because they don't know. They don't know what's possible. You got to figure out what are their problems. So I always start with, especially within the company, we focus on problems because people want to solve problems. They want solutions to it. And the kind of problems that people are interested in is problems they want to make more money. If they're a business, they want to make more money. If they're a consumer, they want to save money. They want to find the best products, in our case. So you try to find out the pain points. And we even do this internally. I always ask people, I'm always trying to figure out, as a CEO, I want to do the best possible job, but I don't have all the answers. So I'm always trying to suss out of people, like, what would you do? We have this thing, what would you do if you were a CEO? I get hit by a truck, how are you going to make this a better place? So I try to focus on, get them to focus on problems. What's the crappiest part of your job? What would you just, what's the thing that you dread every night when you come in here? What is it? How do we, what are the ways that we could be, more efficient? And so you really focus on the problems and you brainstorm, you come up with a lot of different solutions. The one thing about trying to come up with a company, right? You got to start with what's the problem, what's the solution? And you got to come up with a systematic way of doing that. Anyone ever hear of it, ever have an idea? Just an idea. Really? Just not everyone's got their hands up? How many of you had 100 ideas? 1,000. Most ideas suck, don't they? I mean, they're really, really bad, especially if you've been drinking. They always seem like a good idea. It's always good to write them down. One, you won't remember them, but you write them down the next morning, you're like, okay, that was not a good idea. But the key to coming up with a great idea is to come up with a lot of really bad ideas. And the ratios I kind of come up with out of every 100 ideas, you're going to have one probably pretty feasible idea, something that could go to prototype. Maybe out of 100 prototypes, you've got something that could actually go to a company. And then probably one out of those 100 companies is going to go and become a billion-dollar company. So the odds are really stacked against you. So you can wait for that great idea. It's happened. People won the lottery. Two people won the Powerball the other day. It does happen. But usually what happens, you got to come up with a systematic way of doing it. And John talked about the new business plan competition. It's perfect. You should do it. I just got involved with two of the, how many of you have done startup weekends? It's brilliant. I love startup weekends. I had never done it before. I did two in a row as a judge and a mentor, and it was just great. It forces innovation. That's how innovation happens. That's how companies get built. It's forced. It doesn't just magically appear. So you got to come up with a lot of these ideas. There was a great study in TechCrunch. One out of 1,500 companies become billion-dollar companies. Did you read that article? It was a great article. Our financing market's kind of screwed up these days with VCs. They only bet on billion-dollar companies. Now, that's ridiculous. Who here would be happy with a $100 million company? Would be pretty happy? How about a $10 million company? Yeah, I'd be thrilled, you know? I mean, you know, million-dollar company is pretty good. But VCs have skewed so much at the other extreme, they're looking at billion-dollar companies. That's why John and I actually used to work together looking at deals. I mean, sure, we love a billion-dollar company, but a $100 million company, that's a sweet spot. And there's a lot less competition. But one out of 1,500 funded companies ever become billion-dollar companies. And it's like one out of 15,000 ever become sort of the mega, you know, $100 billion Facebook or Google, Apple type companies. So the odds are really, really stacked against you. And the road to being an entrepreneur, how many of you guys want to start your own company? All of you? How many of you want to work for it? You want to work for a startup? How many of you just don't speak English and have no idea why you're here? So it's definitely good to go work for a startup. And sort of the things that we look for, kind of the same things that we look for as VCs. You know, we look for, you got to solve a big problem. And this is what you should be looking at if you're looking to join a startup. Are they solving a big problem? Do they have the best solution? And do they have a great team? Do they have a management team you can believe in? Now, we tend to look for people that are what we call smart athletes. And I think this is kind of a good metaphor for building a company. Now, when we say athletes, that's a metaphor for we're looking for competitive people, people that have put themselves out, right? So people that have either, you know, we love sports, you know, we love people that play sports, especially in high school, right? College sports is a whole different level, especially D1. Very few people are going to do that. But high school sports is pretty reasonable. We're looking for smart, and that's mostly defined by IQ. And that's tough because what you find, we're doing fundraising. I was involved with the fundraising for University of Michigan Engineering, and they kind of bring in some of the, you know, sort of, they put together a group, a committee, and a lot of them were the big initial donors, and we're all sitting there, people have gone out and built some really, really impressive companies, and they're telling us about how great the university is. Like, you know, the average SAT score is like 2,200, and they have like, everyone's got like a 4.9 coming out of high school, and we're all looking at each other like, holy crap, you know, we never would have gotten into this school. You know, so here was a bunch of outliers, all really smart people, but book smart definitely does not. I worry that we've skewed too much towards sort of, you know, SAT and grades. I mean, the grade curve has gone way, way, way up. I don't know, what's the average at UCSB? Three? You think it's three?
Right in, yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean within the university itself.
Oh, everybody gets an A.
Yeah. Except here, you either get a P or an F. So, you know, we're trying to figure out, you know, what are the indicators of IQ, and that is a tough one. You know, getting into a good university, definitely, that's an indicator. But you look at so many unbelievable people. You know, where did Steve Jobs go? I have no idea. Went to some community college in Santa Cruz or something. Anyone know?
Reed.
There you go. Actually, it's an okay one, isn't it? It's a decent one. Okay. Sorry, Reed. We probably get like hate. Sorry, I was talking about different Jobs. I was talking about Dave Jobs, who was a complete loser. So you're always trying to find these like outliers, you know? Are you really smart? And it's not about book smart. And in a startup, like one of the reasons we hire really, really young, we hire almost exclusively people out of school. And primarily the reason is that we're solving problems that no one's ever solved before. And as a startup, and just life in general, you know, we're looking for people that can do things that no one's ever accomplished. Skills are worthless. It's one of the things I do like about the way the education has shifted. When John and I were growing up, it was how much knowledge or information they could jam down your throat. You guys are really, really skilled at finding solutions to problems really, really fast, right? With the internet. We didn't have the internet. What do we have? We had Encyclopedia Britannica. You know, the most exciting thing I had as a kid was we had a encyclopedia set, and it was just so cool. You had to go to the library. So, anyone here ever been to a library? I mean, you probably go to a library here to study or something. I mean, you don't check out books, do you? No. Steal books? So somebody asked me to sign. I wrote a book, and somebody asked me to sign it, and it was sold. This is when you're like a bad writer. Do they have to read the book in this class?
Not this class.
The other class. Anyways, he brought a book for me to sign, and it was sold by his local library. He bought it like on eBay. It was pretty humiliating. I should have turned the guy into the feds. So the other thing that we're looking for also in employees, and this is going to surprise you, you know what the number one reason why people are dissatisfied with jobs? Oh, yeah, that's right, you can't answer because it's on film. But the number one reason, it's going to surprise you, people are unhappy at jobs because they're unhappy people. And so what we're always trying to suss out is are you a happy person, right? Are you going to be, you don't have to be, super cheerful or anything, but do you have a positive outlook on life? And there's really kind of two types of people. And to be a successful entrepreneur, you got to be one of these types. There's people that allow life to happen to them. They think that things that happen, everything that's happened in their life is happening to them outside of their control. And then there's people that make life happen. And that's a really important distinction. And you've got to, if you haven't made that shift in life, you better make it now, because it's super important. You know, shit happens all the time in life, you know, bad things. You just roll with, that's life. That's why they call it life, You roll with it, and you just keep pushing ahead. If you keep putting yourself in a position where great things happen, great things are going to happen. If you're not a jerk in life, people are really nice to you. There will be the creeps. I think I told you, I don't know if that went around. I mean, one of my stories is I actually stopped to help out a serial killer. Was that in the bio?
No, we left that out.
Okay, you left that one out? Oh, that's a good story. All right, well, if you come to find the best, I'll tell it to you over a beer. So even when you help people out, sometimes creepy things can happen. But actually, I'll allude to that story. I'll tell you the story. It's a decent story. Just moved into Cincinnati, new to town, and there's a car broken down the side of the road. Black Trans Am. Kind of dusk out, and I pull over to the guy, and I say, you need some help? And he's like, I ran out of gas. I said, no problem. I live right up here. There's a gas station. I'll get you some gas. We'll go back here. And he goes, no. I need you to take me to this place. It's about 20 miles away, and it was like way outside Cincinnati, kind of in the middle of nowhere. And I'm looking at the guy, and I'm like, what are you talking about, man? I'm not gonna, no, it's the gas station's here. I'll go get you gas and that's it. And I'm going, this is really unusual. This is not normal. And so, a big creep factor pops in my head, and I drop the guy off, and that's it. Read in the newspaper the next week, this guy has killed, he killed two people in this exact same spot. It was a black Trans Am, broken down the side of the road. He had convinced three people to drive him to this place, right? Killed two of them, the other one got shot and escaped and turned him into the cops. And it just always amazed me in life. You know, one, these people, these scammers, and there's plenty of them out there. There's probably 5-10% of the population, at least. Don't you think? There was a guy I knew here that just went to jail for 51 months. A scammer, running a Ponzi scheme. Nice guy in the world. Well, not that nice. But, it just didn't smell right. You know, it wasn't my gut. You don't want to listen to your gut. I mean, the logic didn't make any sense whatsoever. And you see stuff like this in business all the time, where the logic makes no sense. Like, you see all these companies that love this new product, or this new technology, or new product, and you're sitting there going, you know what, I just don't get it. And I used to be like that in a company that acquired us. I'd say, that's a stupid technology. Like, you don't know what you're talking about. I was like, no, it doesn't make any sense. You got to avoid this herd mentality. You know, the herd, if you're an entrepreneur, man, you're going against the herd. Herd is like big companies and stuff. You got to do what others think is not right. Now, sometimes it's not right, but a lot of times it is. You know, the reason Warren Buffett makes so much money is he does what others don't do. It's really incredible. You know, bubbles, people pay the highest possible price at the most insane time. That's just the way the herd works. I remember back in the days, I stayed out of a lot of trouble. I never took a single accounting class in my life, but this very common thing that was going on the internet where people were trading IOs. Like, you know, you give, and the arbitrage for revenue was huge. If you had $1 million of revenue, it was worth $100 million of market cap. So when you have something like that, you have the risk, what do they call that? Moral hazard is quite high, right? So what people are doing is like, you give me $1 million, I'll give you $1 million. And if someone pitched the company this concept, I'm going, you know what, that just doesn't smell right. You know, I don't, you know, this is a serial killer. Not good. I'm not going to do it. And other companies would do it, and a bunch of those guys went to jail, remember? Yep. Good way to stay out of jail and good way to stay out of a grave. So we're looking for happy people. So I'll tell you another funny story. I'm down in LA. I'm driving in LA. And by the way, don't pick up hitchhikers. It's very self-selecting. So this woman, she looked nice. It's raining, and it never rains down there. And she's waving her hands, like, okay, yeah. I pull up. I said, I got to ask you this, man. Are you crazy? I've had so many bad experiences helping people out, you know. And she goes, no, I'm not crazy. I'm like, all right, come on, jump in. And it's dark out, right? It's just like a horror movie. She turns to me. She goes, well, actually, I am crazy. I'm like, she was insane. So, you know, the one thing... the internet days, I love this, find the best, the sponsorship board, advertising. The internet days, they were crazy, weren't they? They were just insane days, and we're still in it. But the early part of the internet days, everything was just too easy. It was easy to raise money, it was easy to get money. It was this whole false economy where people were raising tens, hundreds of millions of dollars, they needed to spend it, they'd come to us, just give us money. I remember one day walking into, I was talking to the president, Kevin Ryan, and he said, I go, Kevin, this is just too easy. This isn't life. Life isn't easy. You know, startups are not easy. It's going to hit the fan. You know, I'm kind of paranoid. There was a great book written by Andy Grove, Only the Paranoid Survive, and it's really good to be a little bit paranoid, just not too much paranoid. And by God, and at the time, I just traveled. Every magazine was covered with internet, like even the women's magazines, you know, like W had the 50 most interesting people to have lunch with, and I was in the list. I mean, I'm not an interesting person to have lunch with. I'm an engineer. I'm incredibly boring. I walked into a Four Seasons restaurant with my wife, and the waiter goes, "Oh, well, welcome back, Mr. O'Connor." I'm like, "How the hell do you know who I am?" And he goes, "Oh, we all know who you are, Mr. O'Connor. We do all the IPO roadshows, and we all like buy and sell your stock." And I'm going, "Holy crap, this is the end." You know, when the internet shows in W Magazine, it's going to get ugly. And like 2 months later, the dot-com crash. It was horrible. 75% of our customers out of business, gone. Fortunately, we had built a pretty sound business, but it's really tough. I mean, when 75% of your biggest paying customers go out of business, it's tough. Fortunately, we had raised a lot of money. So when you raise money in a startup, raise more than you need, because you don't know what's going to happen. A lot of entrepreneurs get kind of greedy. Dilution. I want to smack people when they talk about dilution. You're diluted the day you start the company. You know, you're always going to get diluted. The question is, do you have enough capital for when dot-com crashes happen and to seize upon opportunities? You know, is your stock worth more after you take that infusion of money? If you dilute 20%, can you create 20% more value? You know, if you can't, you got a crappy business. You know, if you can, you want to take the money. And we raised a ton of money. We were one of the last companies to raise money right before the dot-com crash. We raised like $400 million. So we were flush with cash, but we were also burning a lot of cash, and it was tough. So we had that. At the same time, privacy blew up. Privacy was just a huge issue, and we were the poster child. I was Big Brother. I went from being like, you know, hero of the internet, and to just a scumbag. Privacy, and it's kind of I'm trying to think of what it's like now. Privacy is not even, you don't even think about it anymore. We were even doing one-tenth of what's going on now on the internet advertising, right? But boy, it just became this issue, and there was no rules and nothing. And people just started making all these conjectures. So we had attorney generals coming after us, the FTC. We had politicians trying to extort money out of us. It was just a really ugly period. But we got us through all this, and we came out, and it's great. A lot of times, crashes are the best thing that can happen to a company, because the good companies come out. We had great people, we had great product, and we were right, and we fought it. The attorney generals, I remember getting a letter from the attorney generals, and they said, "You know what? We investigated." These were 8 attorney generals came in, and they went through our underwear drawers. I mean, it was ugly. They had said, "You know what? All the stuff we read in the newspapers is false. You're a really good company." And, by the way, can you pay $5 million for our investigation? I said no. But, you know, because we had built the company, we had built it on sound values, we had built it on a sound economic plan, we were providing value to customers, you know, we properly capitalized. We made it through, and we fought those guys. So, I talked about ideas, and a lot of times people come to me, you know, they want to always, you know, you've done some startups, you know, I want to give you my idea, you tell me whether it's right or not, or, you know, bless it, tell me if it's a great idea. And I always tell them this story. I had lunch, early 1996, and it was with a person we were trying to sell our product to. The guy was telling me a story. You know, he had dropped out of, he was a professor at Stanford. He left that job to join the startup. And I went back to the office, and I told these guys, "You'll never believe it. This moron, he had a great job at Stanford. He dropped out to join this company that's doing the flea market on the internet." It's like, how dumb is that? What company was that? eBay. eBay. It's John Wesley. So StubHub. Anyone ever use StubHub? Guy begged me 3 times to invest in his company. I said, "No." He's like, "eBay will crush you. You have one exit. You have one exit in life, eBay. And eBay can crush you at any time." What did he do? He sold it to eBay for like $60 million. So, you know, the thing with me, I mean, I have fortunately come up with some really good ideas. I have passed on a lot of dumb, really dumb ideas. But in the process of that, I passed on some really, really outstanding ideas, and I'm sure you have as well.
Oh, yeah.
And we share some of the really dumb ideas. We get some freaky.
Oh, God, yeah.
like psychopath. Don't we?
Yes.
I mean, one of my favorite lines from a VC was that there's this very thin line between a visionary and someone who's delusional. And sometimes it's, you know, one and the same. And we get these delusional things. They're going to, like, change the world. And a lot of times you sit there, I don't know if you've talked to delusional people, but they're pretty damn convincing. Some people, they go like, man, maybe you can send something through the internet, and, you know, you can send packages through the internet. Or probably not. How much time do I got? You just tell me when to, tell me when I should.
15 more minutes.
Okay. For then questions?
And then questions.
Okay, cool. So one of the things, some of the, I remember I gave a commencement speech in Michigan. It was for engineering, and I thought it was a pretty good speech. And it was stuff I believed in, and then I realized about a year later it was completely wrong. I had, like, given all these people wrong advice. And the whole speech was about following your passion. Follow your passion, right? Whatever you do. And in fact, when I'm doing this in the middle of the speech, I told people, I said, you know, look, if you don't like engineering, if that's not your passion, you should go do something different. And this woman stands up in the stand, and she said, don't you listen to that man. I spent $20,000 in 5 years getting your engineering degree. You're going to be an engineer. And so what I screwed up was that it's great. What you really should do is follow your talent, right? Now, which you're really, really good. My passion was wrestling. You know, I wanted to be an Olympic wrestler. That's what I was going to be. I visualized it. I was going to be an Olympic wrestler. I was a good wrestler. But there were guys that were great wrestlers, you know? Michael Jordan did not become Michael Jordan by, he became Michael Jordan because of a lot of practice. But he was Michael Jordan. He was born Michael Jordan, right? And the people that I knew that went on to the next level, and it wasn't even that high, were, any of you guys ever known like Olympic athletes? They're uncanny. Their eye-hand coordination. I mean, great swimmers, Phelps, he can absorb more oxygen in his lungs. I mean, a lot of those great swimmers purely comes down to lung capacity. It's genetic, right? So it's got to be a talent. It's got to be something you're really, really good at. Now, for me, it was an inventing. It was inventing, and I was fortunate because that was my passion. I love technology. I was really good at it. And so if you can find those two, it's great. But one of the things when you're really talented is something that you typically develop a passion for it. Now, if you're really passionate at something and you're not good at it, you're not talented at it, you become very disappointed in life because you suck at it. Now, sometimes it doesn't matter. Right? You can be passionate about something and it doesn't really matter. I try to kind of do a little bit of both. Like, I try to pursue my passions. Like, I really got into surfing late in life, and I got involved with Surfline. It's great fun. Who here belongs to Surfline? Who here actually pays for a subscription to Surfline? Who uses a friend's subscription to Surfline? You do, yeah. Okay, I got you on record. It's a film. Nice. But it was great. Great site, a lot of fun. And then, you know, you find one of the things you, and for leadership, like if you want to start a company or run a company, you know, you got to eventually become a pretty good leader. And it's an area that's really interested me for a long time, and it's a really complicated area. But one thing I've learned about leadership is you've got to have two or three really, really super strong talents where you've got to be sort of the top 5th percentile. And there's probably 20 attributes that you could have. You know, one of it is sort of IQ. One is charisma, and charisma in a good way. You know, it could be, what are some of the other ones?
The ability to speak in public.
Yeah, that helps. not forget common English words in the middle of a film. You gotta have high, you know, you could have like super high morality, ethics and things like that.
Yeah.
So there's a whole bunch of them. But what you can have, and you can have a bunch of negatives, you can have negatives, but you can't have sort of the bottom 5% negative. Like, you could be a terrible public speaker and be a great leader. I know you've probably known lots of people that are terrible public speakers, but are super great leaders. There's also other people that are incredibly charismatic. Ronald Reagan was probably one of the most charismatic guys ever. Bill Clinton, extraordinarily charismatic. You know, Obama, you know, unbelievable speaker. I'll leave it at that. So when you think about sort of developing yourself as a human, there's always a natural thing that's like, how do we become great at everything, right? That's not important. What you want to be great at two or three things. Figure out what are you super talented, what are you better at than, and I ask people, like, what's the 1%? You're better than 99% of the other people out there. What is it? Mixing drinks, rolling a joint, you know, what is it? Hopefully something beyond that. Maybe not. Legal marijuana, man, it's gonna be a big market. I know one of my shortcomings was anger. I was an angry. There's one thing that pissed me off. Who drives slow in the left lane here? I hate people who drive slow in the left lane. I almost got in like three road rage over here. I got to correct that. But I remember when I was about your age, I punched a hole in the wall in my apartment. I was angry at my girlfriend. I would never ever touch a woman, but I would definitely punch a wall. And I left it rather than covering it up or fixing it. I left it there. I left it as a reminder of how big of an asshole I was, how I let anger control me. Right? You can never let other people control you, and you can never let your weaknesses control you. And you got to figure out what are those weaknesses. And I can tell you one of the biggest weaknesses that people have, especially your generation. Anyone want to take a guess? It's one of the seven sins.
Facebook.
Facebook is actually a cause of this, or at least an exacerbator of it. It's envy. Envy. People get in, and envy is, it's a weakness for a lot of you. It's an envy for, you know, it's hard to believe, you know, Larry Ellison is probably very envious of Bill Gates, or, you know, other people that have more money than he does, you know. So envy controls, it doesn't matter, you know, sort of where you are, but envy controls people a lot. And it, especially, I think, it probably is a bigger impact on this generation. One is because of the social, you know what's going on. Your friends always post, like, positive things or send Instagrams or of great things that are happening, and not necessarily like the bad stuff. We all got bad crap, you know, happening. You know, I get to listen to other parents brag on their kids, and I try not to do it to my kids because it just creates envy. And one of the things I love about Santa Barbara, and you notice that, I love Santa Barbara is very different than LA or San Francisco. Like, I drive my pickup truck to San Francisco. You don't see any pickup trucks there. You'll see a lot of you know, sort of Ferraris and Maseratis. You'll see the, you know, Lamborghinis down in LA. You don't see that in Santa Barbara. This is a cool town. This is a town that is just, people do not want to, people don't want to flash. They just don't think that's important. And that's really, really good. Want me to do some political rants? How many of you all voted for, How many of y'all voted for, or would vote for raising the taxes on the rich? How many of you voted for raising the taxes on the rich, which just happened in California, went up to 13.3%, highest in the country? I wish we could do a little debate here. Maybe we do when the microphones come out. It's like, why? Why did y'all do it? Who do you think is better at investing my money? The government? Really? Anyone ever had a good government experience?
Is anyone on the debate with Kevin O'Connor?
And it's funny because I don't think people think of it this way. You know, what do you think I do? You know, or other people that went up to the 13.3. What do you think we do with our money? What do you think we do with it? Buy G6s? No, we invest in it. We invest the money. So who do you think is better investing my money? Me? Or some bureaucrat who's trying to buy votes? I'm sorry, that's a leading question. I got in this debate with, it was actually the leader of when tuition rates went up in the UC system, and it was a professor at Berkeley. And I remember we had a nice email exchange and we were arguing. She was leading the charge, like, why, this is ungodly. You know, tuition rates are going up at UC. And I'm like, well, Why should a retired old lady in Chico be paying for your tuition? It makes no sense. And she's like, oh yeah, that doesn't make any sense. Sorry. So people tend to forget about it. And I became, you know, when I came out of college, I read Karl Marx. I was like, yeah, communism, this is great. Then I started a business. I remember getting a letter from the state of Ohio wanted to shut us down because we didn't know unemployment insurance. I never heard of unemployment insurance, but we didn't pay unemployment insurance. So they were going to shut us down. I remember thinking, that's a bit of an irony here. the state failed to get, but I finally realized that, you know, an entrepreneur is, and at the last, during the last debates, it was too funny. I don't know if anyone else noticed it. How many times they mentioned entrepreneur in the debates? You remember that?
Yeah.
The savior, the entrepreneur is going to save the country. Entrepreneur is going to save the country. It's like, stop talking about it. Like, leave us alone. You know, the last thing we want is government. In, you know, government entrepreneurship does not mix well, right? All right. So I shouldn't end on a political rant, but we can go to some questions.
All right. Let's give Kevin a hand. Let's go to some questions.
And feel free to ask me anything you want, except what Mike's going to ask me right now.
Anybody on this end?
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Okay.
There you go.
There it is. Okay, so, you know, I always hear people saying that I wish I was born 20 years ago. It would have been so easy to come up with an idea. Or last generation had it so easy. Do you think that's true at all?
No way.
Okay.
So, no
well,
way.
The reason I
didn't even know what entrepreneur. I was literally when I was in school, I had no idea what an entrepreneur was. I couldn't spell it. Probably about 10 years ago. You know, I grew up in Detroit. I mean, there was no entrepreneurs. Last time entrepreneur was like Henry Ford. You know, he was. No.
Well, the reason I ask is you did say it was just so easy at the beginning of the .com.
No, internet. The .com. Okay. Look, at the beginning, it was really hard. We started in 1995, really hard. By 1997, probably 98, it was just, I mean, people were throwing money at it. They couldn't, whatever moved, massive funds were being raised. Then it just became sick.
Okay. Can I ask one more about Find the Best?
Sure.
So what's been like the toughest part to scale at Find the Best? Is it the, you know, talent acquisition? Is it comparisons in your experience?
I don't think the biggest challenge we have is our dependence on Google, right? We get tons of free traffic, as you know, and it's great. And most boards that I sit on or companies I'm involved with, they're trying to figure out how do we get more free traffic from Google. Well, we get all of our free traffic from Google, and it's great. 20 million people come and they experience us. But, you know, we don't want to be dependent on Google. You know, we want to develop that brand. So that's probably the biggest challenge. The biggest challenge is scaling specifically at Find the Best was management. Okay. You know, Santa Barbara is kind of an unusual town. You guys know it's a lot of older people here, or young people. That's kind of, is that a fair assessment? It's an expensive town. You know, to have a family and with kids, sort of to be a senior level executive, experienced executive. There's not a lot here. It's very expensive, or they've done really well and they don't necessarily want to work 80 hours a week. So we had, and you're an intern there, so you saw it. So we had this, sort of this transitional period where people had no management experience at all. Some of our sort of top performers had moved into management, and they've done a really, really, really great job. And now they're just getting better and better and better.
Awesome.
So I think we're over that hump.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Over here on the left.
Yeah, people always say like learn from your mistakes on Behind the Light. Sorry, but like
I'm curious
what mistakes in business that you've made in your startups and your companies that you've learned the most from.
This is one of these things I get asked all the time, and I should have like this pat answer because I always look at, you know, either mistakes are sort of learning experiences, and I try to sort of. You know, our whole philosophy is test, fail, learn, test, succeed, scale the crap out of it. So, you know, mistakes are just kind of a natural part of learning. So I don't really really focus too much on it. And then the really big mistakes, I repress. I just completely I hide them. I mean, look, my biggest regret, I start out with that story where I always want to be in a position where I would speak my mind and do stuff. My biggest frustration at DoubleClick, and the reason I left as CEO, the primary reason, was that I was in a position now running a public company. We were, you know, very high profile, and I could not say what I thought. I was really, I had a lot of masters. And, you know, if I really said what I thought, it was not good for my stockholders. Whatever I did, I was going to get sued. And so when I stepped down, I vowed to always be in a position where I could say anything I want, and I'm willing to accept any consequence. So the mistake is probably allowing myself to get into that. I found myself in this a cognitive dissonance that I really, really struggled with, and I could not figure a way out. So I've made lots of mistakes. People mistakes I make all the time, because you just never know.
We got one right here in the back.
Okay, so as far as market research you were saying, I kind of have a curiosity. Since the internet is so broad, it goes all over the world, it's global, do you find that with market research in your style of company that if you look close to home, does it match what other people across the globe are looking for? Or do you find that you have to almost go global with your perspectives?
You know, I think that, I mean, we've just expanded internationally over the last year. I think there's definitely differences in markets, but my experience is that, you know, what people want in the United States, we're very much a global. Definitely in the developed countries, you know, it's pretty much the same. The markets of the competitors are going to be different, but it's generally the same. You know, for us, you know, with the internet, for example, the way I've always tried to figure out whether something's a fad or not, you know, in hindsight, it's easy to find out the internet. But when I first got into it, I'm like, okay, let's see, the internet. You can be anyone in the world can tie into this thing and get access to the world's information. That's a big idea. That's going to be good. You know, and the same thing sort of with PCs. So there's certain fundamental needs that are all over the world. And finding the best, that's what we call to find the best, but you know, people always, when people have to make big decisions in life, we're really focused on helping people. There's this information asymmetry that exists with the marketer. The marketer knows everything, and then the consumer or the buyer is a baby gazelle waiting to get mauled by the marketing lions. And really, when you have information symmetry within a market, the market flows a lot better. People feel more comfortable making big decisions. Now, it's not good if you're a bad company. If you're a bad company, information symmetry, horrible. Good company, good. But we don't care about bad companies. Yes?
Hello.
So so the internet was like the trend for your generation. What do you think is the
PC
trend
was
for,
like trend? PC was the trend of my generation.
Oh,
I was like an old man.
What do you think
internet.
The trend for our generation will be?
I mean, clearly mobile. You know, I mean, are you technology? Are you computer science?
No.
Oh, that's too bad. Any computer science guys here? Who's computer science? Raise your hand.
Who's doing
Comp Sci? Because we have a couple of engineers here. We're going to be probably all over here. So what's your background? What's your degree?
Just economics.
Economics. That's a great degree. We hire a lot of econ folks because we do a lot of quant. So great background. So what are some of the big trends? I mean, clearly mobile. I mean, that's off the charts. You look at the penetration of stuff. The internet had one of the fastest penetrations up to its time. Smartphones is just so far off the charts, and you guys have probably studied that. I mean, it's ridiculous. Some of the other stuff, I think robotics is actually finally going to happen. I've always been very negative on clean tech. I think clean tech is largely garbage because it's government. It's not economically sustainable. You know, energy is the underpinnings of everything we do. And I just, it's kind of like raising taxes and everything. It just doesn't make any economic sense. People, if you have cheap energy or expensive energy, which one are you going to buy? It's a commodity. Which one? You're an econ major.
Well, what about nuclear power?
Well, so I won't get into, I mean, we have so much natural gas, by the way, is going to save your generation. Natural gas is one of the best things that's ever hit this country. That is a massive trend. But I'm not sure buying natural gas or being involved with that is going to be really good because there's going to be a glut. But think about things that are going to be dependent on natural gas and manufacturing. Manufacturing is going to come back to this country. That coupled with robotics. Now, it's not going to employ that many people. It will employ some people, but it's going to all come back here. It's not going to be good for China. China's going to have a bad decade.
You mentioned the dot-com bubble a couple of times. Do you think that the market is currently overvalued? And do you think that right now is a good time to start a business?
So, I mean, we don't have the same, you know, you take LinkedIn. I don't know, what's LinkedIn trading at? It's like 50 billion, you know? I mean, LinkedIn's an amazing business, amazing business. Is it worth 50 billion? I have no idea. No idea. You know, I passed on the Twitter, you're talking to a guy that passed on the Twitter IPO. I sold Facebook at basically a loss. You know, stock picking is not my thing. But what I can tell you, I mean, one of the reasons, you know, I ended up doing okay on the internet is that I didn't know, you know, I knew so many people. I knew a guy that was worth $850 million and ended up with zero. Zero. Because people on the internet, and we were all like this, we believe in it. You know, it's a big story. You know, a lot of value was created. But people got greedy. Bears and bulls make money and pigs get slaughtered. Remember that. And so people got, you know, there was guys that were taking taking their stock that they had in their internet company, borrowing on margin and buying more of their stock. That's dumb. That's not good. So whether things are overvalued or not, there's a lot of really, really valuable companies that are out there being, you know, that are created. How valuable, I have no idea because I'm not a stock guy. You know, I sold Google at, I think, the IPO. I thought it was overpriced. I sold DoubleClick for $1.3 billion, and 3 years later, they sold it for $3.1 billion. I was that guy. So,
well,
I don't know.
DoubleClick,
so we sold DoubleClick, and that's a long story. It was the right thing to do. The company needed to be, we had a lot of cash, too much cash, actually, believe it or not. Any finance guys here, but too much cash is a problem. Apple's got this problem, right? It's hard to, a dollar is valued at a dollar. And then the other thing is we had to spin off some companies. Very hard to do in a public company. So the company needed to go private, and it did. So it was the right thing to do. I don't know why Google was at, when we sold the company, Google was there, but decided not to buy it. They decided, I guess Google liked to buy things at a higher price. I don't know. I haven't heard the whole story. But it's an important part of Google. The one thing I'm most proud about our companies is that when our companies, they get acquired, they go off and they continue to do great things. I mean, Google and DoubleClick. DoubleClick's done very well under Google, so that's good. So I appreciate it. This is always a real honor. I loved it. I love this interaction. Love the school. Appreciate it, John, for having us here. Findthebest.com/jobs if you're looking for jobs, or you can go through John.
Absolutely.
But appreciate it, and hope to see you all around town or Uber or at Find the Best.
Great. Thanks, Kevin. Let's give him a hand.